What's up, everyone? We're back for another episode of the Tom Hayden Show. I'm so honored this guest is giving me his time. Dude, Abdullah, I can't wait to talk to you. Should I call you by your Twitter name, your Discord name, or your name from the stream, by the way, too? I should have asked that pre-show. I didn't, and I'm realizing I did that now when I went to go intro you. So,
I think most people know me by my Discord name, my Twitter name,
Sempra.
Yeah, exactly.
Done and done. So we got Sempra on the show, the winner of the Vancouver Regional. So yeah, I'm going to kick it to you. Introduce yourself to the people. Tell us a little bit about yourself and how you got into Pokemon.
My name's Sempra. I got into Pokemon, I think, 10 months ago or 11 months ago. And I've been watching Pokemon for much longer. I've watched it for about a year before this. And I really fell in love with it because I got to watch these incredible players. It was mostly Wolfie and Cybertron at the time. Mm. And it was like,
yep.
How can I be as good as them? And that's been my goal, just to one day be even remotely close to them. And that's why I stuck by it.
Well, dude, you put your name on the same list as them being regional champion. And we were talking about this a little pre-show. You and Justin Tang put your names on the same list as Wolfie as going to your first event and winning the whole thing. But so you got into Pokemon 10, 11 months ago. Is that like the competitive scene you got into 10, 11 months ago? How did you get into that, by the way, if you don't mind me asking?
Yeah, that's probably the competitive scene 10 or 11 months ago. Like, but before that, I used to play like really casually. Like,
okay.
I used to just chill and complete the games. I think that's all I used to do. I used to complete the games and
put it down.
Yeah. And then watch Pokemon. That's all I used to do.
That's what I did with Sun and Moon. I didn't watch, though. I just, like, played the games. Was like, yo, this is fun. I like this. And then never played competitive.
Yeah, I think I started all the way, like, X and Y or Omega Ruby Alpha Sapphire. But all I would do is complete the games and then put them away.
Did you know what EVs and IVs were back then or no?
No, I had no clue.
Yeah. So when did you, how did you get that knowledge of EVs and IVs? Was that more recent in this past 10, 11 months?
Yeah, that is... So, actually, I remember what it was now. Okay. I bought a Brilliant Diamond Shining Pearl.
Shout out, Brilliant Diamond Shining Pearl.
Yeah, and that game was really bad. But I loved it because it was the first time I've taken it.
I have a friend whose little brother couldn't beat Cynthia, and I would check up on him.
I couldn't beat it either.
Every couple of weeks, I'd be like, did you beat Cynthia yet? No, I didn't. All right, so level up your Pokemon to 55. Get everyone in your party to 55. Not just your level 75... Empoleon, you know, with only water moves. I was trying to help him out so bad.
Yeah. No, I felt that. I felt that too many times. Yeah, I think that was the starting point. Yeah, I think wow. So. And then I think what happened was I would play Battle Tower, and at one point I stumbled across JoeyoX9's channel, I think it was.
Okay.
And he made a video. Yeah, I think I remember the video. It was like how you can use a level 1 Smeargle to win ranked battles. And I remember seeing the format he was playing, and I had never played double battles, and it just looked so much fun. And I wanted to use a level 1 Smeargle to beat people. And so, I think that was the beginning of me playing Pokemon.
Dude.
Was that level 1 Smeargle.
That's really recent. Like, that's really freaking recent. That's cool as hell that you've been able to climb the mountain and win a tournament that, like, how 300-plus people were at, right? Like, that's insane, yeah. Bro. Like, congratulations again. I know I said a pre-show. I didn't say it since we started recording. Like, that's such a cool accomplishment. You should be so proud of yourself.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. And when you first started getting in, how did you meet your little crew that you got, that you started testing with? Because everyone has a VGC crew, I've noticed. Like, how did your little crew come together? How did you meet your people that helped you get better and improve at the game?
I think I started getting into the Pokemon, like, a lot when I discovered Sword and Shield, because BDSP does not have a very big competitive scene.
Yeah.
I bought Sword and Shield, and that had a much bigger competitive scene. I started around Series 12.
Okay.
And after Series 12, around Spikemith, I guess I started discovering, like, online tours, and that's when I started, like, actually understanding competitive Pokemon.
Oh.
And after Spikemith, I found, I think it was a Smogon tour.
Okay.
That was how I met, like, actually started meeting people. And that team had, like, JoeyoX9 and NJ11, who are, like, NJ is, like, another Canadian player. And
yeah.
It was through there that I met, like, actually really good players, like, Yotam, who...
Kick-ass player.
I think he's famous for his Talent Tusk team that did really good.
He does well in all the online tours because I help judge the Beanie Brawls.
He's incredible. I don't know how he does it. I don't know how he has the stamina, number one, like how he can get through so many rounds. But and the other thing, I don't know how he does so well in every single tour he goes into.
Yeah, no, I saw his name start popping up, and then I met him at, I think it was either Orlando, and then I saw him again at Knoxville. We were both getting our Switch checked at the same time. Said, oh, not surprised to see you here. I was about to go to the winning end. I was 6-2. Yeah, we were both 6-2 getting our Switch checked, because that's when they start checking everyone.
You're right, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, last round, people. Yeah.
Good people right there.
Exactly. And so I met him. There were some really good players. Like, it was Justin Karras on that team, too.
He just won a New Jersey local, I believe, or a Philadelphia local, too.
Did he? He's also the guy who also helped with the Yotam Toller Tusk team. Talent Tusk team with Toller. That was... Yeah. I think, if I'm not wrong, I might be completely wrong, but it started from that server, like, Yotam and Azazel coming together.
That's awesome.
But from there, I got into, like, an MPA team, and so my team group was, like, people combined from those teams, and I wouldn't call it a team group. I feel like we mostly just discuss teams and the meta, and obviously, I can't say I team-built a team when I stole mine completely.
But that's how everyone starts. Like, I asked around. I was like, does anyone have a team I could use? Like, because I was looking, too. In Orlando, I found a team. It was a dumbass team. I had no practice, bro. Let's rewind a little bit. I'll go into story time before we get into your accomplishments. I broke my tooth in half, and I stuck my finger in a deli slicer. It's healed up now.
Oh, my God.
And my grandma died, too. So it was just like, bam, bam, bam. So I didn't practice at all for Orlando. I probably should have canceled the trip. But I was just like, all right, you know what? I'm going. And I found a weak armor, weakness policy, iron bundle, flip turn team. Like, and I would flip turn into the armorage. I went 5-5, and I was just like, I'm having a fun. I don't give a fuck about anything. Let's just go in and have fun. And that was the first time I didn't build a team. So I found that team, and I was like, you know what? I think I got to be a little smarter and start, like, asking friends or finding better teams. Because I know I could – I started 3-1. I know I could pilot it decently no matter what I bring now. I just want to figure out, like, the strong team. So you found that strong team. You found that team that you were like, oh, this is awesome. And you even said in your interview, I'm sorry to interrupt, you said, I'm surprised I haven't seen more mirrors. So talk about that team and how you, like, found it too, man.
Yeah, I'm so surprised there weren't more people playing it. Like, I remember just before the regional, I was almost convinced. I believe it was Battle Room who ran a setup Volcarona team.
Okay.
I thought I was going to bring that. And honestly, I came off like a really, really good series one. I did really good in my draft leagues. I think I was undefeated at that point, like 5-0 or 6-0 or something.
Let's fucking go.
Against some really good players, right? And I felt really good about series one, but then series two, I was like stuck. I hit a brick wall. I felt so bad. I couldn't cut online tours. Like, it felt terrible. And so I was like, I'm going to bring the setup Volcarona team, and I don't know, like, I'm not a setup player. I don't play setup at all, but I felt like the only thing I was working. But after, I believe it was Knoxville, that Nails
got Nails top got, four. Yeah, you got second, right?
No, I got top four, I think.
Top four, okay, yeah.
Yeah. So after that, I think I had the message open. It was like, I messaged the team building group, like, what do you guys think of Nails' team? And a couple minutes later, I sent a message. It was like, Flutterman used a Boom Blast. Garganog lost 100% of its health. And then right after, it was Baxcalibur has Terrasize into Water type. Flutterman used Moonblast. Baxcalibur lost 100% of its health. And it was like, at that point, I knew that was the team I was going to run. That's just so broken in it.
Yeah, the specs. And then, oh my God.
Yeah, I fell in love with it. It was just so, so broken. It was so offensive, and yet it had such a defensive core with the Dragonite, King Gambit, Tusk. Like, that core is so unbreakable for so many teams. And so I thought that team had zero flaws, and I really did, because I think Nails talked about it somewhere, but I literally changed three things about the team. It was a singular EV into Dragonite speed. It was Power Gem over Ice Beam, which I clicked zero times. I clicked Power Gem never. I just never clicked it. And it was Terra Steel on Great Tusk, which I felt like was a good change. But I love that team so much, and I feel like it was such an amazing team. And I don't know, maybe something about weather. Like, Gavin does incredible at OCIC and wins the whole thing with rain, and we just see zero rain teams. I feel like it's just people are scared to go into weather. Something like that. People close their eyes after Nails had such an amazing performance, right? And I really think Nails is one of NA's best. And so I was so excited to finally find the team I liked. I peaked ladder with it. I was beating my friends. I was doing well against other players, and it was just... It felt like the team because it was so broken, and I feel like I had to put very little thought into so many matchups, and it would just win.
And you, so before we get into the actual event, what made you sign up for the event and start prepping the way you did and looking for the teams you did? Like, what made you sign up for Vancouver?
At the original reason was just to meet friends. That's literally it. Wow. I had absolutely no expectations. I just wanted to meet people because the community had been so nice to me, and I wanted to meet the people I was talking to, and that was the original reason.
And oh my god, bro, that's so cool. Like, that you just went in to make friends and meet people in the community because you're like, I'm really liking playing Pokemon. Let me go to this event and see how I do. And then you find the team that you're really sold on. You start doing well in all your prep. So when you started doing well at the actual event, what was going through your mind? Because how did you – I don't know your exact win-loss record through day one. So, like, when you started doing well day one, what was your thought process, like, going into lunch and, like, at the actual event after lunch when you realized you might make day two at your first ever event?
I think I ended 9-0 day one.
I forgot about that, yeah.
Yeah, it was just so awesome after 4-0. After 4-0 is when it started really sinking in.
Yeah.
I had lunch with Anjay and Joe, and I tried to talk to them, and they might have realized this. I was, like, spacing out because I was just thinking about how awesome it was to go 4-0. And I was just thinking about what it felt like to be on stream, because I was with Luca most of the day, and during lunch... We watched him play, and everyone has daydreams about being on stage, right? And I was just imagining what it felt like if I was on stage. Round 5 was pretty easy. Round 6, one of the event organizers, I believe it was one of my friends who had messaged the event organizers, telling them my tweet and ever that I said I'm going to go 1-8. They found that tweet, and they're like, you got to be on stream. And it was against Battle Room, right? I was going to bring his team.
Oh, my God. So,
exactly. I really look up to the player, and it felt... I was so scared. And then the matchup ended up being really bad. Like, the Talon Tusk...
Didn't matter.
T-tar, I was really scared. But I was just so happy to be on stage, and when I won, I think you could see it in the first interview compared to my last one. I almost cried. I was about to start crying beside Gabby. I was just
You were probably so overwhelmed. Can we talk...
Yeah, exactly.
I took notes on the last two games you played in the tournament. Can we talk about the Battle Room game and the... Going into that, the weathers, because you talked about how strong you think weather is. Having a T-Tar against a Torkoal, you led Lily Cole the last five games of the tournament. Did you feel you could safely, like, what were your lead thoughts into a T-Tar opposing weather team, if you don't mind, going into that?
So, against normal T-Tar, I can usually bring Torkoal, but against Tusk, Tailwind T-Tar, I just can't bring it.
Yeah.
It's just too weak against that team. Too slow, too frail, and I already knew the matchup beforehand, so I knew I'm not going to bring those to the Lily Coil court, and that's where I feel like I started realizing how amazing that team is. It's like,
yeah, because you have those options.
Sun is your whole premise. Exactly, Sun is your whole premise, but you have this incredibly bulky option of King Gambit,
Dragonite.
King Gambit Dragonite, exactly, which carried that set.
Yeah,
and I began realizing, like, how incredibly well this team was constructed. Every weakness the team has, someone is out there covering it. And I feel like Nails needs all the credit. Like,
shout out Nails.
Shout outs to him. He just built such an incredible team. And it was after that Battle Room thing, I was 6-0 after Battle Room. And then after that, I played Gavin, too. And Gavin's Gavin, right?
Gavin's Gavin.
He's such a good player.
Wait, so you had a killer run up into 7-0. Who were your 8-0 and 9-0 rounds? I wish I, like, took notes on that before, but I forgot you went 9-0, to be honest.
I don't think there were anyone, like, very out there in the community. Maybe I'm wrong and I just offended them as they're watching this, but...
Dude, I get like, who cares if they're a little offended? Everyone doesn't know everyone, no matter how big in the community they are.
Yeah, exactly. At least I didn't recognize them. Yeah. But they bought double Trick Room. It was double Hard Trick Room. And that team was a very, very good matchup into Hard Trick Room. You have your own Torkoal, which goes crazy in their Trick Room.
Yeah.
You have, again, the Dragonite King Yamacore, which Armors and Diddy just can't touch.
Yep.
I feel like that team is very, very good into Hard Trick Room, so I felt very comfortable playing those two. I believe I 4-0'd the two matches, so.
So, after the event, what are you thinking at that point? You go 9-0 at your first freaking regional, bro.
My favorite player is Amelia Forbes, and so that's the only thing that came to my mind.
Built different.
Yeah, exactly. I love Amelia so much. He's my favorite player of all time, and I guess I realized what it might have felt like to be him, and I was just telling everyone around me about my matchups and how awesome it was to play someone like Gavin, who Gavin's incredible. Gavin's so, so good at the game. I used to finish my rounds early and watch Gavin's games, because I would watch this guy make the greatest plays I've ever seen and reduce them to, like, a couple predictions. Gavin is so good at the game, so it was so different to beat him. I also hacked him out of the... It was a 2-0, but I hacked him out of the second game. He had to hit 2 out of 2 pumps, and he missed one of them.
That's not hacking out. That's what happens when you run Hydro Pump.
Yeah.
That's just what happened. Actually, there was a big miss in the finals match, I thought. A big Hydro Pump miss.
That one didn't matter as much, because it doesn't yeah. Oko the Torkoal. It had to Oko to matter.
Yes, so I wasn't sure of the calcs there. I was like, actually, I don't... Because I saw how much damage it did to your Torkoal the first time. I was like, I Torkoal had just taken the Flare Blitz from Arcanine, but we could get into that later, too. Because, like, bro, at this point, you must be on cloud 9. Did you do anything fun after the event, or were you just too tired to, like, really do anything after?
No, I didn't do anything. I went to one of my dad's friend's house as I ate, and then I came back to the hotel. I think I prepped for a single team, and that was Neil's team, which is a very weird team. I prepped for that one.
Shout out Neil for that. That's an honor of your Neil.
No, he like definitely redefined a lot of what Dondozo is. I gotta give him that.
Oh god.
That was a very weird team. I had to really think that through. Yeah. And this was when my phone was like blowing up. Yes. I was getting messages from everyone, and I got a very kind message from Nails, and I believe it was that time, he messaged me, you know, keep your head up and play well. You got this. And that felt so awesome.
Shout out Nails. That's so cool to hear from the team creator when you borrow the team without, like, knowing them.
Exactly. And it's someone as good as him. He's literally one of Benny's best players, and it felt so awesome to hear that from him, that he was supporting me.
Bro.
And I had a very bad night of sleep. The clocks went forward, so I didn't sleep very well. But I woke up, and the first thing I did was I talked to Calvin Foster about the Neil matchup, and we couldn't figure it out. I feel like we had some kind of a game plan, but it was very difficult. And that was the only match I was worried about.
Oh my god!
But yeah, it was so awesome after that first day. It was just all I could think about was that.
Yo, I remember actually. I took a nap after Saturday. I watched the tournament, took a nap. I woke up. I couldn't go back to sleep. I watched Mandalorian. I was, like, up late. It's, like, 4 in the morning. I'm on Twitter. I see. I'm like, oh, I don't follow this dude. Let me shoot him a follow. And you followed me back, like, right away. I slid into your DMs like, bro, go to sleep. It's 4 in the morning, forgetting Vancouver was on the West Coast. And I thought that was very funny. I was like, I can't believe how on your phone you are. Because you responded right away, too. I was like, this dude's probably getting so many messages he has to respond to. Like,
that entire night I was either on my phone replying to people or I was studying the matchups. It was one of the two. That's all I could think about.
So, what do you eat for breakfast before day two? Did you eat breakfast? I
forgot. I forgot to eat breakfast.
So you show up to the
venue. I didn't eat anything at the venue either. Yeah. I didn't feel hungry at all.
Your adrenaline was like, we got this.
Exactly.
It's tournament time.
Exactly. I forgot to eat. So, yeah.
And so I don't know your record in day two, actually. I probably should have done that research, too. What was your record in day two?
I went 3-2.
3-2, but you were able to make it to the top 8 because of your strong performance in day one. Amazing. And what was the hardest match before the top 8, right? Because that's how It was five rounds of Swiss, like, in Knoxville, or am I wrong? How many rounds of Swiss were there before?
It was five.
Five rounds. So, what was your toughest match before the top cut bracket?
I feel like every match was so hard. I played everyone from top four, and the other two opponents I had were in top eight, so I had, like, a really hard schedule.
Yeah.
And the hardest match was definitely the streamed one. I played versus Dylan, who I played again in top four.
So the first time you played versus Dylan was not on stream?
Yeah, it was on stream.
Oh, it was on... Yeah, okay. So yeah. I only took notes on the second one. That second match was fun to watch.
Yeah.
I only took notes on the second one. I do remember seeing that first one. The first match was awful. One. For you?
Yeah, I just...
Yeah.
I couldn't... Like, the match before, I lost to Neil, and I lost one game because I missed Leafstorm into Sleep Powder. And I just did not want to win Lilligant after, and that's a very terrible mindset to have. Like,
yeah,
it's like the gambler's, like, reverse gambler's fallacy. It was like, maybe I got unlucky the match before, but like, that is literally my only matchup, and that's Torkoal Lilligant, and I got blown away. I think I got one knockout to his four both times. Like, I got destroyed.
Bro, Lilligant 90% accurate leaf storms are infuriating. Or is it 95?
Exactly. No, it's 90. It's like, it's unbelievable. I actually think I hit more sleep patterns than leaf storms. I don't know how it happened. It's not 90%. It's just not 90%.
Yo, I think of it like a wheel spinning, and there's just a hit or miss wheel with a little sliver to say miss, and it always lands on the little sliver.
Somehow,
it's so annoying, bro. Oh my god, you hit more sleep powders and leaf storms is hysterical.
Yeah. I was definitely, I think I was 2-2 or 2-4 for leaf storms, and I was something like, so I went 2 out of 4 day one, and then I went 5 out of 6, or something like that, 4 out of 5, and that was, I only used sleep in Dylan's match.
So, in the second match versus Dylan, you actually missed it turn one, too.
Yeah.
In the top four match. Yeah.
Like, I had to keep my cool, because I did the same thing versus Dylan, where I got unlucky just before that, and then I didn't want to rely on sleep powder, which is a very bad play.
Yeah.
So, it was like, I had to calm down. I was like, I'm going to click the sleep powder again, and this time it's going to hit. And thankfully it did. And, yeah, that was a very good match. I played very badly in the end game. I did the calc after on the close combat, the +2 close combat on my Torkoal. It shouldn't have mattered if he was like max attack. I think it was like a 6% chance to KO. But yeah, I wasn't too happy after that. I feel like I didn't play very well, and I just had to rely on sleep powder.
Torkoal surviving that close combat was fucking crazy, actually.
Yeah, exactly. I misplayed so bad. Like, I had a guaranteed win.
That was game three, too.
If I counts out. Yeah, I don't know why I played so bad. I had a guaranteed win if I counts out Cleave. But I don't know. I feel like I felt like after the 3v1, I already thought I had won. So I threw so many times. I threw by sacking my Flutterman for no reason. Who Oko's the Tauros. That was a terrible play. And then I sucker punch for some reason the turn after, so it was very bad. If my Torkoal got crit, it was like sucker punch mind games. So I wasn't proud of that. So.
I was actually in my notes too. I was shocked when your Fluttermane survived the freeze dry turn one, on like, what was it, 8 hit points? I think it was something like that. I was like, oh my god, he's probably running like. Were you running a bulkier Fluttermane, if you don't mind me asking that?
Barely. I think. It was 20 HP.
So that's crazy, too. Then I was like, that bundle did not KO with Fluttermane. Fluttermane's just that naturally bulky. Let's fucking go.
Yeah, it's very bulky on the special side.
It's very... my God. And I thought your game 2, turn 1, the after you eruption call was great, even though you ended up losing that game. I loved your lines. And just being like, I'm going to KO the Fluttermane and do big boy damage to Tusk.
Oh, that was... This is finals, right?
I was game 2 of your set versus Dylan versus the, right?
Dylan was the Sandy Shocks.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, the Sandy Shocks was, and then that's how the Sucker Punch, the defensive,
Yeah, defensive tear, exactly.
Yeah, because they led Sandy Shocks and not Roaring Moon.
Yeah, exactly. So,
oh yeah.
This is the matchup where Nails really carried me.
Okay.
He gave me every line I went for, and he gave me offensive calcs where I was like, "Do you have a decent chance at KOing, Okoing no bulk AV Sandy Shocks?" And for some reason I messed up the calc. I think the round before, he flare blitzed one of my mons, got down to like 3/4 HP, and then I erupted
and he KO'd.
And so somehow I mixed up those calcs, and I thought that it O-code with eruption. And so I thought I'd O-code the Tauros at the very least, and I'd have a chance of KOing the Sandy Shocks, which is completely wrong because both of them survived. I didn't feel like it was over yet. I don't remember exactly how that.
They KO'd themselves with a flare blitz recoil.
Right, okay. And my Lilligant went down. So he was actually very smart at recognizing that I need my Lilligant more than I need my Torkoal.
Yeah.
Because one of my. Well, my line was basically I expected him to lead a Roaring Moon Tauros like he did in the Swiss match.
Mm-hmm.
And one of my lines is basically I'm going to lead Lilicole, I'm going to swap out Torkoal to run and go for a Sleep Powder. And then after that, it was after you Dazzlingly. it was very weird to do. But that was the line. And I had to change the entire game plan because he didn't lead that. And so.
The after you Dazzling Gleam is so nasty. It's just like.
Yeah, exactly.
That's why I thought you might have been a bulkier Fluttermane too, because I was like, if he's gonna after you, he doesn't need the speed as much.
Yeah, no, it's very fast. It hits very hard. It has like 84 defense EVs and 20 HP. I think that's about it.
Dude, oh my god! So then, in this match versus Dylan, you win on that close combat survive. You know, like you get that sense of. Like, overwhelming and, like, probably bunky off your back. You're going to the finals match. What was going through your mind after that match?
I was disappointed. That's it. I felt like I played the endgame so badly. And
you got bailed out.
Yeah, exactly. I deserve to get crit. Like, I don't know why. I look back at that, and I just threw so hard. I have no clue why I didn't swap out my Fluttermane. It took an icy win, so Taurus was faster than it.
Yeah.
That was a confirmed win right there. Catatau Cleave was a guaranteed win. Like, I had so many guaranteed wins, and I just threw all of them away. I didn't lose if the Torkoal, like, got crit or something.
No.
But then I had to play Sucker Punch mind games, which I'm very bad at. And so I was so disappointed in myself. I was like...
Did they have a setup move on Tauros? I'm not too familiar with Dylan's team.
They had a Wisp.
Oh.
So, yeah, it was really weird. I was like... I wasn't very proud of myself. I was like, I really got the finals playing like this. And I...
That should show you how strong the team is, too.
Yeah, exactly. So, the team really did carry me.
And going into your match with Ryan, you had played him when before? Because you said you had played everyone in the top four. So, when did you play Ryan the first time?
I think second match of Swiss.
Okay.
Day 2 Swiss.
And, did you won 2-0 in that one?
Yep, I won 2-0. And
did you lead Lilicole both games, too?
I led Lilicole game one. I think I led... Flutter Cole game 2.
Yeah,
the Flutter Cole game was much easier. Because... no,
that's a funny way to put it.
I got the switch up right.
Okay.
I predict the switch up, so... I think he misclicked his Terra. Mm-hmm. Is what he said in the end game. And he would have won it. I'm pretty sure he had Terra available, and he got the call right. He just didn't Terra. And... It would have been a much closer match without it, yeah.
Okay. Is that the end of game 2 in the finals, you're saying? When he...
No, that was
game... Oh, the Swiss.
Yeah, game 1 of Swiss, yes.
Game 1 of Swiss, yeah. Oh, my God. Because I thought this was a really good matchup for you.
It was. It's an amazing matchup. I guess that just goes to show how good of a player he is, that he even made it close. It's such a good matchup for me.
Yeah. And it was just, like, Lilicole, force he thought you were going to after you eruption, so going for the Leaf Storm there and protecting your Torkoal I thought was an amazing play.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm pretty sure the play he went for with the EQ Shadow Ball was he's predicting either after you eruption, to which his Fluttermane goes down, and I think he thought, and I did too, that EQ would KO the Torkoal.
But it didn't.
It didn't. So that's something we found out in game 2. But in game 1, he went for the Shadow Ball onto my Torkoal, so if I went for Sleep Powder onto his Great Tusk, Team Kenny on my Torkoal anyway. So he was covering for both those options, but I went for the third option, which was Lee storming his Great Tusk. And that ended up paying off, so I felt like game one was kind of sealed after that.
Hmm. Because then, shortly after, you just got, it was Arc and Bundle versus Flutter and Torkoal. And having Flutter and Torkoal on the court at the same time is just overwhelming power on the fast end and the slow end.
Exactly. You can't beat that. I went for Terrifier Eruption because he can't bring the Torkoal low enough to where Eruption doesn't KO his Arc anyway. Mm. And I went for Moonblast on the Bundle. Because if I took the kill on the Bundle, I had Great Tusk in the back who would always clean up. So that game was sealed after turn one, I'm pretty sure.
That's crazy.
In game two, yeah, exactly. In game two, I predicted... I didn't predict him to go for another EQ.
Mm.
I because in this matchup as well, Lilligant is much more useful than Torkoal.
Mm.
And he had Booster Energy Bundle, and Leafstorm always OKOs that, even at minus two. So I was playing around that, but he recognized that he needs to get rid of the Lilligant, like, whenever possible. So he recognized that very well, and he played to his outs, right?
Mm.
The matchup was very, very bad for him, and he played incredible. Like, I gotta give it to him. He's such a good player.
He is such a good player, and he's such a nice person.
Dude, he's such a nice person. He, like, before either of us were guaranteed to cut, he was asking me about my matchups, and we were just having conversations and stuff. He's such a genuine person.
Yeah.
Like, I can't say enough good things about that guy. He's so nice.
I can't either. Again, like, he went out of his way to help me prep for San Diego. I was like, do you mind? And he hopped on a phone call immediately. And I was talking to him. I was like, I kind of wish I recorded this for the podcast. I told him that when we were prepping for San Diego. So now I'm excited to have him on, because I'm recording with him later this week. I'm recording with him Saturday. So I'm going to put that out probably the week after your episode. Actually, no, 2 weeks after your episode, I'll put that one out. Because, yeah, I told you, I'm going to drop this one right after this. Like, I'm going to upload it to YouTube, put it on the Apple and Spotify stuff, and just call it an episode right after we're done. Because I want the people to hear this, man. This is a fun conversation. Like, I am a Pokemon junkie, I noticed. Like, I love talking about these events, watching the events when I'm not there. Like, going to the events I've been to, and, like, hearing about someone's experience is so much fun to me. And, like, the fact that you climb the mountain, that everyone that signs up goes there and wants to win. You wouldn't really go if you want. I know you said you went because you wanted to make friends, but you also wanted to win at the same time, you know? So,
yeah, of course.
Like, this... Bro, this is, I can't say congratulations enough. And what has been, like, the coolest thing that's happened that you wouldn't have expected? I know that's kind of like a out of the blue question. I didn't tell you I was going to ask, but, like, what is something that just surprised you after winning that's been happening?
I guess I gotta say something, like, about how awesome Cybertron is.
Yeah.
Like, I just can't say enough about that guy. We played round one of day two Swiss, and it was a very, very close game. I'm pretty sure, so what happened in day two is, I got held up at the gate, and they need to see your snapped wristband, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's something that's normal, but they needed that, and I didn't have it. So they almost didn't let me in, but one of the ladies recognized me, who was working at the front. She said that, like, that I was actually a player, and that I had to play my set right now. And I believe, like, all my matches, I was marked as late. I'm pretty sure they gave Cybertron, like, the opportunity to... I didn't ask him, but I think they gave him the opportunity to take a game win. He didn't take that, and so we had, like, a very clean, awesome best of three. And that wouldn't have been possible if he took that. And I don't think there's anyone out there who would have, like, given the opportunity to play an actual best of three.
Other Bro, than Cybertron, so. I'm telling you right now, if I'm your opponent and that happens, I'm taking the win. I paid money to go to the regional.
I'm being honest.
Yeah.
I take that right away.
He's there because he thinks he's one of the best in the world, and he doesn't want any, like, cheap wins, probably, too. So he's like, let's play it out, and then you won.
Exactly. It was so awesome. And then
you beat... Oh, my God.
Yeah, it felt so awesome being Cybertron. But two rounds after that, he started talking to me about the matchup and about my team and stuff like that, and it was just... He came up to me, right? I didn't say anything to him. He was just so awesome. Like, I can't say enough about how amazing Cybertron is. So that was, like, I thought. So I kind of forgot. It slipped my mind that Cybertron actually plays in Vancouver a lot of time. and rather than casting, I thought he was gonna be on the casting crew, but when I didn't see him, I felt like I felt down because of course I want to see Cybertron. But when I found he was playing, I was so excited. And I just wanted to play Cybertron, like win or lose.
And then you ended up winning.
Yeah.
Bro, that's amazing. Yeah,
it
no.
It was so awesome to see so many amazing players. Like, I played Gavin twice, and Gavin is like, they say he's him. He's literally him. Gavin is so good at the game, and he's so talented. Like, I think NA is so lucky to have Gavin. I just can't say enough about how awesome Gavin was as well.
Bro, are we going to see you at any upcoming events? Are you coming to any more events this season? Or because you're now one of those players. You're on that list for people. You won a regional. So people want to see you.
Yeah, that's crazy to think about, but
yeah.
I got to think about it. I had no plans after this. Because I obviously didn't think I was getting anywhere.
How many CP you got? You got 200.
I have 200, yeah.
Yeah, bro!
It's definitely much closer to a yes than it was before. That's all I know.
Okay.
But for now, I don't know if I'll be anywhere else.
Are you on the West Coast or East Coast, if you don't mind me asking?
I'm West.
So, man, there's Portland, there's Fresno, there's... You got options if you want to make a trip down to the States. So I hope...
Yeah, exactly. I think Portland's pretty close, so I've been looking at that.
If you decide to go, the sky's the limit. Like, you put yourself on a short list of people expected to do very well now. So if you go, just like, it's going to be different than going to your first regional to make friends.
Yeah,
I hope you realize that, too.
Exactly, yeah. And that's, I guess that's one of the reasons I've been thinking about it. Like, I don't want to choke because I actually need to do good to get points.
No, don't. It won't be choking, you know? Just think about it. Go in, have fun. But, yeah, no, you have the ability to do very well at all these events. And I think the sky's the limit. So I really hope to see you more this season and see how, you know, if you do get that invite to Worlds, man, like, I want to see how you do there, too. Because, again, showing up to your first regional ever and winning is not a small accomplishment by any means. Like, you
yeah,
did
it's,
it. You
it's
did
so
it.
Awesome.
Sorry to keep talking.
No, I really appreciate you talking because I can't think.
Yeah, I don't shut up either, so that works. But, like, man, yeah, like, I can't imagine what you're going through with everyone reaching out, so I really can't say thank you enough for your time. We've already been on for 40 minutes, so is there anything else you want to mention before we get out of here?
I just want to thank everyone. Like, I got so much support. It was just so overwhelming, like, how awesome everyone was. I just want to say thank you.
Dude, thank you. Because again, like, it's so cool to hear people's VGC stories and to see you getting into Warren Spikemuth to now winning a regional in this format, like, that's so close to Spikemuth. That is incredible. I consider myself a newer player. I started, like, Series 5 of Sword and Shield. That's when I really started, like, playing more competitive and doing draft leagues and stuff. Like, the, not the player draft leagues, the, Draft 11 Pokemon draft leagues.
Oh, right, yeah, yeah.
And that's where, like, I started my competitive little journey. But, like, hearing how you got into it as, like, a casual fan into, oh, I saw this Smeargle at level 1 into, like,
yeah, exactly.
Everything and now being, you're a regional winner. That's not a long list. You're a regional winner now. So I love hearing your story, and I can't thank you enough for your time.
Man, I really appreciate you having me on here. It was so awesome to talk.
Let's fucking go. But on that note, I think I'm going to end the recording here. And thank you, everyone who listened this long. I appreciate each and every one of you. And I'll see you guys next time.